protests in the United States into a question. How would you explain them to your children? And how would you explain the protests and the death of George Floyd and Black Lives Matter to your children if your children are black? Last week I read this. It's a really stunning piece of writing by Clint Smith. You can find it online in a really fine American magazine called The Atlantic. I recommend it so much. Becoming a Parent in the Age of Black Lives Matter. I've pre-seed it pretty badly, but I wanted to make all of us who are parents think about this. And about the point, Clint Smith, who is also a teacher, a PhD from Harvard, an acclaimed poet and more, raised in a much-viewed TED talk he did. How do you make children understand the realities of the world without also making them accept an unjust status quo as inevitable? These are really big questions. And we're so delighted and grateful to have Dr. Clint Smith with us this morning. Dr. Smith, it's so good to have you on Breakfast. Thank you for joining us, because I know it's Sunday at home, so we appreciate your family time. Thank you.
Happy to be here.
Boy, that's a fine piece of writing in The Atlantic. And you say, my children are both a respite from all the tragedy transpiring in the world and a reminder of how high the stakes are. And that is a particularly black experience now, isn't it? That awful juxtaposition.
In many ways, I think so. I think that, you know, when I spend time with my kids, you know, we're also in the midst of quarantine in the U.S. and social distancing, and child care providers are closed. I have a three-year-old son and a one-year-old daughter. So, you know, during my time with the kids, we go to this park down the road from our house. And, you know, we pick up sticks and we play, pretend we're wizards. And we try to, you know, change each other into farm animals. And we blow dandelions and we run and play tag. And we do all these things that you do with young children. And when I'm with them, I'm not actively thinking about so much of the despair that exists in our country right now, that exists in the world right now. And yet they are, when I spend time with them, a reminder of, as you said, how high the stakes are. And they are a reminder of why it is so essential to build a better world than the one we have now, because this has been an intergenerational conversation in Black Americans' homes. It's a conversation that my grandfather had with my father had with me, that I will one day have to have with my own children. And I'm thinking a lot about what that conversation looks like and how do you convey to a young person the realities of the world without making it seem as if they have done something to deserve it.
I'm going to quote you to you. As one of my friends put it when thinking about having a two-year-old son in this moment, it's the discomforting juxtaposition between the joy of seeing the world through his eyes and knowing how the world will see him one day. And
right.
And how do you talk about that with children? And there's an amazing example of how your dad talked about it with you when you were out having a water pistol fight in a car park and your dad came and dragged you inside because...
He explained that the reality, you know, I grew up in a very mixed race, mixed income community, black friends, white friends, Asian friends, you know, it was like the Disney Channel in the U.S. And we were this interracial amalgam of young people. And I, when I was young, I didn't think actively about my relationship to them in terms of the color of my skin. But my father made clear, he was like, the implications of you playing with what is even a toy gun or a water gun at night are so different than they are for your other friends. And when you're a kid, you don't understand that. You think you're the mean dad, you're the strict dad. Why can't you be more like, you know, allow me to do the things that my other friends are doing? And I didn't fully understand it then, but now that I have my own children, you understand the risk that are involved. And I think we've seen over the past several years the sort of fatal manifestations of the fear that my own father had when he saw me with that gun, because there are examples like Tamir Rice, you know, in Cleveland, Ohio, who was shot while playing with a toy gun when he was 12-year-old. Police shot him within 2 seconds of them pulling up. So it's a real thing.
You talk about George Floyd in your article in The Atlantic, in that beautiful piece of writing, and you talk about his children. Did they run through open fields together, blow dandelions into the wind, play tag until they fell breathless and jubilant to the ground? I hope that any memories they carry will supersede those of their father on the ground begging for his life.
Yeah, I think it's really important that it is a balance. I think it's a balance both for Black people generally, but also especially for our children, that we make clear that we have experienced Black Americans, you know, 400 years of oppression through enslavement, through Jim Crow, through state-sanctioned apartheid, through mass incarceration, and that we are in many ways still experiencing the oppressive systems of this country, but that we are also not defined by that oppression. Mm. We are not defined by that violence. We are not defined by the things that this country has done to us. Instead, we are defined by our laughter, our joy, our celebration, our families, the people we love, in the same way anybody else should be defined by those things.
In your poem, No More Allergies Today, you write, "Today I will write a poem about a little girl jumping rope. It will not be a metaphor for dodging bullets." Mm. And in the title poem of your book, Counting Descent, you say, "I still believe we can build this world into something new." And I wonder, do you still believe that after George Floyd and everything we are seeing in the United States?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that we're actually in a really remarkable moment in which we're seeing protests across the country in huge cities and small cities and rural areas and urban areas sustain themselves in a way that we certainly haven't seen in my lifetime. And in many ways, they are so different than what happened when Michael Brown was killed or when Eric Garner was killed in 2014 and 15 at the sort of advent of the Black Lives Matter movement. And I think people in the United States have a new vocabulary. They have a new framework. They have a new understanding that is systemic and structural rather than interpersonal of what racism is and how it manifests itself. And I think as a result, we are moving, the conversation around racism in the United States is much more sophisticated than it was several years ago. And I think as a result, we are in a position to see different policies that will significantly, hopefully, impact the Black community.
So in the midst of the protests and in the midst of the sadness and grief and rage about George Floyd and all the other names that we know, you are still feeling some form of hope.
I think so, because I come from a long tradition of people who continue to work against all odds. You know, I think of enslavement. Black people in this country were enslaved for 250 years. And there were people who were fighting against slavery every single day of their lives since the day they were brought to these shores. And the vast majority of people who fought against enslavement never saw the end of slavery. But that doesn't mean that their work didn't mean something. That doesn't mean that their work didn't contribute to the work that the next generation did. And that at some point, an opportunity opened up or enough people were chipping away at that wall that eventually we got to the other side. And so the work that we do now even is not so that I can see the fruits of its labor, or not even so my children can see the fruits of its labor. So it is so someone, you know, in an intergenerational way, you know, beyond me, generations from now might live in a radically different world than the one that we do now.
Thank you for your contribution to that, Dr. Clint Smith, whose beautiful piece of writing you can find online at The Atlantic, and his poetry collection is called Counting Descent. We so appreciate you joining us in New Zealand today. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.